Okay, sound check, check, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Sound check, are we coming in clear?
Alright. Sounds pretty good to me.
Oh, great. So how you doing, Clutch?
I'm doing all right. I'm
awesome.
Ready to make the big transition next week to doing this full time.
Well, I definitely want to discuss a lot about that. Maybe I'm not sure we'll be able to get to all of that this session. As I mentioned in email, I want to focus on the business perspective. I want to come at this from the point of view of an entrepreneur or someone who is a Lego collector or likes Lego and is interested in selling Lego. And watching your... And in fact, I watched every single one of your Ask Clutch videos. It took me about 3 weeks, I think. I came to understand a whole lot about... Okay. Oh, by the way, there's a 60-second delay.
Okay.
I failed to mention that. I had this on a 60-second delay, so we might... Yeah. Let me get my background here. There we go. That's good. Sorry. Okay. Were you able to hear my background, or was it just silent for you?
Hear it. Oh, it was audio? I guess it was silent then.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure if my background audio was getting mixed into what you could hear or not. Okay, that was another one of my sound checks. Because I also have the live stream up to make sure it's functioning. This is my first live stream for Lord's Ira TV, so a lot of little things we're trying to iron out to make sure it works.
They're nerve-wracking sometimes.
Well, yeah, I guess one of my problems is I'm a little bit of a perfectionist, which is great if you want things to be done well, but horrible if you actually want it to get it done.
Well, you know that you are live right now, right?
Yes.
All right, good. I've had my share of problems trying to run the Transformers live stream I do on Wednesday nights.
All right, so I've already done my advertising on Facebook over the last few days especially, and just did another round about 15 minutes ago. So maybe we'll get a few people on, but if they don't, that's also fine. As I mentioned before, my primary goal is to interview sellers that have been online for at least 5 years, and whether that's been part-time or full-time, and effectively create a book for somebody who is approaching this from the point of view of, hey, should I sell Lego? Especially when they read a article online that says Lego is better than gold or something to that effect. And I want to kind of debunk the idea that that's something they really want to do because they're going to outstrip the stock market in their return on investment. Okay.
A lot of people are getting into it, that's for sure.
Well, and that's more even more reason to create a book where those who bother to do their homework and research will no doubt pull ahead of those who make all the mistakes and not learn from everyone else who's already made those mistakes.
Yeah, so I had a comment on one of my videos a few days ago from a video that's over 3 years old, and it was an Ask Clutch, I believe, and I was talking about the largest Bricklink stores on Bricklink, largest stores on Bricklink, and their comment was simply that I was completely wrong about what the largest store was, and I responded like, you're aware this is a 3-plus-year-old video, and they claim to just be making newer viewers aware that it's outdated information or something like that. But in looking into that accusation, I saw that the sizes of stores has really increased to based on how big my store was and where I ranked back then versus now, there's a lot more stores and they're a lot bigger.
Right. And I don't expect that trend to reverse anytime soon.
No.
So the established stores will continue to progress in that fashion that we've seen in the previous trends. So that's one of the things I want to kind of get into. We're going to start off with a little bit about myself and transition into a little bit about you, and then basically focus on you. And it's not a show for me. It's actually a show for you. All right. So I'm going to leave my banner here up for a few more minutes while people try to come in. Okay. So make sure I have my other stuff here going.
I can go ahead and post about this too right now.
Cool.
I don't know if it'll have any effect, but I'll try.
Okay, so anyone who has been who has bothered to join our live interview of Quench, I welcome you. We will be starting in another minute, so I appreciate your patience while we wait for others who may be interested in viewing our interview.
All right, it is on my Facebook and Twitter now.
All right, another 30 seconds and we'll start. Okay, let's go ahead and get started here. I'm going to take off my splash screen so that I can get a good look at myself. Hi.
Lots of cool Lego. That's what everybody wants to see. They don't want to see you. They want to see the Lego.
Yeah, let me move out of the way, okay? I have what I call Ninja Machi. So in Japanese, that's Town of Ninja. Anyway, so let's go ahead and get started here. So for those of you who have joined, I thank you. And I invite you to view this mini series where I have compiled a list over 100 questions. Some of them are commonly asked in his Ask Quench series on his YouTube channel. Considering the value of time, it makes sense to divide these questions up and cover each section. We will attempt to limit the time to about 1 hour. Any questions left unanswered will be picked up in the next session. So we do hope to see you in future live streams. The sections are Unstart, Birth of a Bricklink Store, Daily Logistics, Honest Advice, and Looking Forward. The goal of this series is to compile an ebook that will be the starting point for any Bricklink seller to read before they start. Quench and Bricks on the Dollar will not be the only Bricklink seller to be showcased in a forthcoming book. However, he will be the first to share his experiences in building a Bricklink store. As an entrepreneur, I know lunch is never free, nor easy. If you're expecting steady pay, it's best to find someone else to work for. If you enjoy taking risk and betting everything for a better future that may never come, then I invite you to dive in head first on the deep end. Just to start off the conversation, I'll mention a little bit about myself. My name is Richie Bartlett, and I live in Japan. My online nickname is Lore Zyra. And so this is for lorezyra.tv. I'm a 38-year-old entrepreneur who has failed more times than I care to admit. But it only takes one successful idea to elevate you to the next level. I emerged from my dark age towards the latter half of 2015. After almost 20 years of no Lego, I found myself in my favorite electronics toy store on the Lego aisle. I was immediately brought back to my earlier childhood days where I had a fair collection of Lego sets, about 50, I think. At the time, I realized that I had missed it so much, and now I can afford to catch up on lost time. I found all kinds of resources online aimed at AFOs. I even had to learn new terms that surrounded the Lego community. I found Bricklink and YouTube channels on what, how, and why, all about Bricklink. I found Brickset and Rebrickable.com websites, excellent utilities and tools for managing your existing collection. Eventually, I found Bricksar before I found Clutch. It wasn't until Bricksar named Clutch that I started to hear more about him. From that point, I thought it was good to research more about Clutch. It didn't take me long to find the Bricks on a Dollar channel and Bricks Online Bricklink, and Clutch Online Bricklink store. I tried out his service, and I never regretted it. I would encourage anyone to give his store a visit. From bricksonadollar.com, you'll find all the appropriate links to his channel as well as to his Bricklink store. Definitely give it a try. Now, I have over 1,000 sets and more than 200,000 parts. I currently have a private Lego store that focuses on collectible minifigures. Prior to starting my own adventure into running an online Lego store, I had researched much about retailers and logistics plus operations. I only wish there was some online resource that I could tap into and jumpstart my venture as a Bricklink seller. This brings me to you, Clutch. I would like to shift the conversation on how you began with Lego and the journey that led you to build Bricks on the Dollar. My focus of this interview is to dive into some of the deeper questions in logistics and points every budding Bricklink seller should know before they start their own store. I don't know if anyone has ever told you how to build or run a business from the ground up, but most people that did not study business management in college are highly unlikely to know what entrepreneurship involves. You must have the determination and passion to continue forward regardless of the obstacles ahead. Few people can do this without formal education or mentorship. I have observed your business grow. It's easy to see you have an unwavering passion to bring Lego to all those that need parts. How about we start the conversation with some fun questions? So first of all, I know I've mentioned a few times where I thought you should write a book on your experiences. But seeing how you have not expressed any interest in doing so, I'm happy to take the mantle and run with the baton. Would you mind if I used your name, your nickname, and shamelessly plug the store name of your store name in my ebook?
Not at all.
Now, I know you are commonly referred to by your nickname, which is Clutch. May we all know your legal name?
My name is Chris Byrne.
Awesome. So tell us, where did the nickname Clutch come from?
I was joining the Your Creative Friends YouTube team when they were doing videos, and they each had, the whole family had nicknames for themselves on their Lego channel, and they were generally Lego-themed nicknames. They didn't use alliteration, but I kind of went the way of alliteration with mine. My name's Chris, so I wanted to pick a C word, and clutch is a term used by the Lego group. Bricks can stick together and then come back apart and stick together once again. That.
Okay, kind of lost it a little bit there. I couldn't hear the whole answer. All right, so basically it was alliteration on the My Creative Friend show, you said?
Yeah, I used alliteration to wind up with Clutch because they all had Lego nicknames, and if I was going to be on their channel, I needed to have some sort of nickname as well, or so I figured I should. And with alliteration, Clutch Chris, it made sense.
Cool. You ever go by Clutch Powers from time to time?
Every now and then I do. I do enjoy that movie. It's a fantastic representation of the product line of 2009.
Yeah, actually, I have almost all the Lego movies that they've put out. So I thought it was rather interesting. So tell us about how you got started with Lego.
Well, I left for college, and when I was home for breaks, I realized how much Lego I still had from when I was a kid. I hadn't touched it in a few years. This is the dark ages between 2002 and 2007 when I went to college. Going to college in 2007, that is. I came home for breaks. I saw how much I had, and I didn't want to just leave it in the heaps that it was in. I found the website Piron, which somehow is a pretty good net for finding people coming out of their dark ages. I don't know how Piron does it. Must have some pretty good SEO. But Piron finds you, and then after Piron finds you, you find websites that are worthwhile. So I found Piron. It allowed me to catalog everything I had. It had inventories for all the sets. They might not be correct, but they had inventories for all the sets. I started putting back together all the old sets I had, because when I left into my dark ages, all the Lego, no sets were assembled or bagged or anything like that. It was just one mass of bricks. And finding Piron let me build all my sets. I believe Bricklink was advertising on Piron at the time, where if you wanted missing pieces, you could link over to select Bricklink stores that had their price quotes posted on Piron. I think then in 2009, I joined there and I bought a whole lot of parts. I probably was the kind of buyer that me as a seller now really dislike, because I was buying the odds and ends to complete slightly incomplete sets. So that's one of this, two of that, times I don't know, 100, 200 lots.
Wow.
I found Bricklink. I bought a bunch of parts. I actually bought a bunch of parts from a store that was only 2 miles away from where I lived. And I went and met this gentleman who runs Bricks to You in Pennsylvania. And I was amazed by his setup. His setup is tiny compared to what I have now. But at the time, he had about 100,000 parts in like a dedicated small office. And I thought that was really fascinating to see what a Lego collection built for sale looked like.
And so you mentioned you had a bunch of sets.
Sure.
Oh, sorry. You mentioned you had a whole lot of sets. I couldn't imagine how big was. Do you remember how many sets you had?
I believe it was somewhere around 300 sets.
Oh, wow. You had a lot more than I did when I was a kid.
I don't know that I had that many of the larger sets, but I had a really sporadic spread from 92 through 2001, I would say.
Okay. That's about the same range I have from the 90s. All right. So you were getting into how you were starting to buy into your other Legos and try to complete your sets. Did you have other members in the family that were into Lego?
My younger brother was into Lego. I believe he helped me a little bit in getting these sets back together. Whenever I was home for break, he would gravitate towards the ones that he liked more. He actually probably staved me off from my Dark Ages for about a year, maybe 2 years. He's 4 years younger than me, so I would chalk anything from 2001 through 2003 up to really it was his leaning that got me to buy more sets than, instead of just cutting it off right after the Star Wars series came out.
Okay. So of those themes that Lego had from the 90s on or even before, what were your favorite themes?
I seem to not have a lot of the themes that I today would think would have been cool to have then. I didn't have many pirates. I didn't have any of the big ships. I might have had two or three of the small 10 or less dollar sets for that. The same goes for castle. I didn't have anything of any substantial size. I had a lot of town. Before it was city, it was called town, and I had mostly town. I had some time cruisers. I had all the spin-offs of town. I had a lot of different space sub-themes. Space and town were the big ones for me. And again, I don't think I had very many of the 40 plus dollar sets. That's why I don't think any of the main Lego sub-themes really stuck with me, except for town, because cars are small inherently, so you could get smaller sets and still have plenty of cars and trucks and things like that. But I didn't have any big pirate ships or big castles or monorails even.
Actually, I don't think they have monorails anymore.
No.
So for some reason, I thought maybe you were a fan of Blacktron. I thought maybe, because I thought you said that in one of your videos or something. Okay, so would you...
Blacktron 1 is my favorite theme, but it was before my time. I like it now. I wasn't able to have it back then.
Oh, I see. Okay. So what did you find so fun and appealing about Lego as a child?
I always had a lot of sets built, but I definitely had a lot of loose parts too. I don't know if I took apart stock models to build whatever I wanted or if I supplemented my collection with a lot of flea market and yard sale finds. This is before eBay or Craigslist were that big or even around. But I always remember building a lot of my own stuff too. I can remember pretty vividly in sometime in middle school. Instead of paying attention in class, I was mentally putting bricks together in my head and thinking of the build for a bomber airplane that I wanted to build. And actually, I was not considering the wings or the engines or anything like that. I was thinking about the mechanism that would drop the bombs out of the belly of it.
Oh, wow. So that sounds like more technique type style, but that's definitely what would appeal to me. I'm more of an engineering type guy. That's pretty cool. So in kind of progressing forward here, in Ask Quetch video 214, you mentioned how you may have jump-started your dark age trying to build a massive mock using all the pieces that you owned at that time. What else would you say may have contributed to your dark age?
It wasn't a different toy collection necessarily, because I had all the toys I had as a kid, I had them all at the same time somehow. Maybe that's why I didn't have any large Lego sets, because I also had most of these back here. I started working at 14, which would have been, I think, 2005 or so, maybe a little bit earlier now. So I started working towards the end of middle school, right at the beginning of high school. And that's a pretty easy answer to give for going into my dark ages. But I might also have been displeased with the juniorization of Lego, because right when I was going into my dark ages is when they were cutting the part count and introducing things like Jack Stone. And I might not have enjoyed the sets I was buying. World City was, I believe, World City was just coming out when I was going to my dark ages. And my brother was really into the 5 or 6 different police sets they came out with. And we had the smallest 3. But that was probably the last dregs of the Lego that we bought, that and maybe a little bit of Lego Island Extreme Stunts.
Well, I remember times when Lego was kind of going a direction I didn't really recognize what they were doing, and that also probably contributed to my lack in wanting to get back into it for a while during my dark age. Now, you pointed behind you, and I know you're also big on Transformers. And I was big on Transformers as a kid as well, although I don't recall having collected many of the figures that they came out with. Perhaps you can explain a little bit about your fascination that goes into, or maybe let me rephrase this question. Can you say having Transformers might have at all influenced anything you would have done in Lego? Maybe have tried to build something of a Transformer theme, but in Lego?
I wouldn't say so. I never tried to build anything that transformed necessarily. I definitely used a lot of hinges when I was building as a kid. I did have like surveillance vans that would like open up a la micro machines, I guess you could say. But I definitely kept the Lego and the Transformers world separate. I can't remember any time where I would play with both of them at the same time. The Transformers I go after are the Hasbro American toy line from 95 through 99, which is what they call Beast Wars. That was Transformers for me, because that's when I was receiving and buying toys.
Okay. Kind of shifting gears a little bit. Something I heard you say on a Behind the Beer episode, can you explain the definition of what scramble means in relation to Lego?
So most of us have experienced going into a Walmart or a Kmart or some less than stellar retail store that carries Lego. And we've seen what happens when, for one reason or another, somebody rips open a Lego box and maybe takes some of the parts, maybe doesn't. I don't know the motive, but there'll be a bunch of loose parts all over the shelf, kind of pushed to the back. And the minifigs are usually gone, but this is something that is going to be swept up and thrown away by anyone who's working, cleaning, stocking at the Walmart. There's absolutely nothing they can do to recoup that loss. So Scrambles was born from an episode of the cartoon Ed, Edd n Eddy, where a jar full of coins is dumped out on the ground and everyone runs to pick up all these coins. It's the funny part is that those coins once belonged to them in the first place. They were kind of being swindled out of their money, and then they got to pick up all the coins again that they had spent. But that's irrelevant. The word just kind of fit. Scrambles is when you take the soon-to-be-thrown-out refuse bricks from the shelf. There's not a barcode in sight associated with these things. And they are yours now.
But
it,
of course,
it doesn't count if you go and you ask somebody about it.
Right. But of course, with that, it's not something we want to encourage anyone to just start ripping open anything at a store and just taking it because there's no barcode. Of course, if you have to take a suitcase to the store to clean up the store aisle, you should probably be prepared to buy the aisle.
Yeah.
So, okay. In that same episode on Behind the Beer, I remember you giving a name to your car. Would you enlighten anyone on what that name is?
I'll start with my motorcycle. My motorcycle is named Nightbird. It's named after an episode of Generation 1 Transformers in which a female ninja robot is created by some Japanese scientists, and it is named Nightbird, and that's about it. I believe in toy form, here and there, it has turned into a motorcycle before, but in the show, it was just a robot. And with the motorcycle having a Transformers-themed name, the car has been named Swoop, or Shattered Glass Swoop, and that's going to be a mouthful. So Swoop is one of the Dinobots. It's the pterodactyl, pterodon, whatever you want to call it. And Swoop is also the term given to buying out the entire stock of a product at a store. It doesn't have to be Lego. It can be anything. But as long as you are taking it from a stock shelf to an empty shelf, then you have swooped whatever was there. I do some videos where it's almost all about the quantity rather than even how good of a deal it is. Because if you're going to part a lot of Lego sets out, you need to get as many as you can. So I've done my share of swoops. And finally, the shattered glass part comes in because shattered glass is a third party lore in which the good guys are bad guys and the bad guys are good guys in Transformers, and I wouldn't have my car being a good guy, so, and Swoop being a Dinobot was a good guy in the shows. He's an Autobot or Dinobot, whatever. So I just kind of flipped the tables there, and it's Shattered Glass Swoop, but that's more than you wanted to know.
Well, no, the key here is we're trying to understand more about you and what motivated you into becoming a Bricklink store. So that's why we're discussing where you came from and what you're doing. So when you're talking about going to a store and doing your swoops, you're literally driving your swoop car that you named Swoop to get your swoops at the store.
So yeah, someday I hope to maybe get the car wrapped, if not this car, then a future car, but wrapped with bricks on the dollar on the side.
Oh, that would be fantastic.
So they can see me coming for the swoops.
Well, speaking of getting swooped or something along those lines, what would you say is the largest Bricklink batch order you have received over the last few years?
I think last time I had to answer this question, I did a little bit of digging and I found that it was 16,000 parts, and I think it was about $1,600. It's right about 10 cents a part, which is it is my average for 2016 parts, items sold, I should say, not just parts, but items sold are right at 10 cents a part, 10 cents an item across the whole year. But it was to a gentleman in Washington State, I believe. I kind of guessed that, I guessed at who he was and what he was doing based on his email address and the address, the company address he gave me, but that doesn't necessarily have anything to do with his need for buying Lego. I believe he said something about coming out of his dark ages with his, I think, daughter. And they found my store through watching Bricks for Chris, and I guess I had a good price on parts, or I had the parts they wanted, or they didn't care what I had, they just wanted to buy a lot of something because they placed an order. I haven't heard from them since, which is unfortunate, but they placed a pretty nice order.
That sounds a little bit like myself when I came out of my dark age. As I said, I found myself able to afford it, and I've spent well north of, well, if anyone's seen my Christmas video, I had well over $4,000 worth of Lego merchandise that I had purchased, and that was my Christmas. So I could definitely relate to wanting to get back into it and diving into the deep end. So do you look forward to seeing more orders, large orders like that in your store?
Definitely. A large order that can pay for my employees' whole week in one shot is always great to see. It means that I might have reached a tipping point for some of the lots in my store in which they wouldn't necessarily sell until I had a certain amount of them. And seeing someone come in and clean out 800 out of 800 of a particular part means that I finally reached the critical mass for some of the lots I had. And I hope that with large orders, I get to prove myself as a store that they can come back to in the future. Although it's where they shop is completely up to what stores have the parts they want.
So any plans or strategies to build up to the point where these type of orders being in large quantities become the norm?
I have been modulating my pricing structure recently to find the sweet spot of where I want to price to make sure my store stays the right amount of liquid. A lot of people ask me, and I'm sure we'll get into enough questions about dead inventory down the road here, but a lot of people ask me about how long some of the parts have been in the store and how long it'll take to sell them and why I even try to sell some of them.
Right.
But I need to find the right price to make sure that everything in the store is still attractive to the buyer.
Absolutely. Okay, so let's move on to the next section. We're doing pretty good on time. We're at half hour mark here. Let's go ahead and move into the next session, which I called Birth of a Bricklink Store. I know you've done an excellent job. You've been at the store, correct me if I'm wrong, but more than 6 years. So if you could think back to 6 years ago, why sell Lego? What triggered you to start selling Lego?
So as I was saying earlier, I found Bricklink as a buyer. I joined as a buyer in May of 2009. I started as a seller in September of 2009. And as a buyer, I became aware of the fact that you could sell anything and everything. In fact, what I was doing, I was completing all my sets, and then I was making lists of the sets that I never had as a kid and that I would like to buy. I was also assessing the recently completed sets as far as, do I really want to keep this in my collection or not? By September, I was ready to start selling some of those completed sets. I listed sets at probably too low a price and sold a lot of them very quickly. As I made my first sale my first day, which isn't necessarily too common for a brand new Bricklink store, and I only had 30 or 40 different used complete sets in my store. I managed to sell, I remember what it was, so I guess I'll throw that out there. The first set I sold was the, from 99, when they had the minifigures on the little stands with the cards on the back of them, way before it was collectible minifigures, but they're still collectible. I sold a Ninja 3-pack. I think it was the more common one. It's probably the two green ninja and the shogun. I sold that for probably less than I should have to somebody who gave me a chance. I guess I didn't have zero feedback, but I had zero feedback as a seller. They also had auctions on Bricklink back then. I took pretty good advantage of listing things on the auction section.
Do you recall what you felt when you got that first sell? What kind of emotions that you got when it's like, oh man, I just got that first sell?
I know it was great. It was reassuring that I took the time and bought a lot of parts to complete all these sets again. And I'm sure I immediately went towards, what do I want to buy with these, or how do I ship a product once I sell it? Because prior to that, I don't think I shipped anything in my life. So, I remember back in those days, I would go to the post office and use the, actually go to the post office twice. I didn't have a scale for weighing things. But I would go to the post office and get a quote of what it would cost to ship something based on their scale, despite them urging me to buy my own scale. And then I'd charge them and they'd pay, and then I'd have to go again. I guess I bought the thick padded mailers that they have at the post office back then, and I don't know, maximum expenses. I am still printing, cutting, and taping on my shipping labels. I still have not got to adhesive labels or thermal printers or anything like that. I'm still rocking the old printer. But yeah.
So thinking back to that first sale and then comparing it to now, what would you say is the best part or joy of selling Lego?
I really enjoy the fact that, and I've said it many times, people are able to build anything they can possibly imagine through the sellers of Bricklink, through the Lego Lug Bulk program, through the bricks and pieces, through the pick-a-brick wall, through even buying sets yourself and kind of breaking them down. And I've been to my share of Lego conventions and seeing the things that these gifted people are building, and then knowing that none of that's free, all of that comes from somewhere, and most of it is beyond a private collection, as far as a child would receive, you know, one of this, one of that. So they put in a lot of work. They were able to get all the pieces they needed or the pieces that they could get. And knowing that I don't even know these people. I don't ever see the mocks they're building, but I know people are building great things with the parts that they're getting from my store. That's the best part to me.
So, do you ever build much Lego yourself? Now that you have your own store, you can grab whatever part you wanted in theory.
I could. I don't build much. I think the last time I built anything was the 590 sets that I bought a few months ago and took some pictures of. I don't even think I did video reviews on those. That was the last thing I built. I like to say that my building skills have not improved since I was, you know, 12 years old, that kind of thing. And
but that doesn't make you any less creative.
Not necessarily. The building physically hasn't evolved since then, but I do know all the new parts. I do know how they could work, how they could go together. So I understand fully what people are doing when they're building nowadays, but I have never done it myself. I did build yesterday. I built a complete Lego alphabet in about, let's see, it's 4, 6, almost 7 bricks tall, each letter. I built them to the scale of a shirt I used to own that said just build on it. And I think there was some significance to the artist who made that shirt. I don't have it anymore because I've sized out of it and t-shirts don't last forever. But I built A through Z, all modeled after the 8 letters that are on that shirt. And I'm doing that for a new project that I'm working on with Bricks on the Dollar. That I thought it would be better to have these brick built letters ready to go. So I spent yesterday building 26 letters and photographing them.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, I've always been looking for t-shirts that are Lego centric. And the problem I have, especially here in Japan, is finding an adult sized Lego t-shirt. There are some, but they're usually aimed at the mothers who are not exactly my size. So they'll make it for an adult female, but not one for an adult male, and they'll have the kid size, obviously. So I would definitely look forward to finding some kind of t-shirt that I could buy, or if not, make myself.
That's a very common problem over here, and it's led me down a path that I've taken in the last few months, in that I was at Legoland in California, and I wanted to get a t-shirt for myself. I'm a t-shirt guy. I've got this motorcycle t-shirt on from Target right now, and I wanted to buy a shirt at Legoland, but the choices in adult sizes were very slim, and all the shirts that I particularly enjoyed were all kid sizes. I actually settled for an adult shirt. Probably should have gotten none, but I settled for one in an adult size just to get a shirt from there. And this led me to a couple of the projects I'm working on now, one being the poster subscription service, where I want art for AFOLs. And that's what I'm doing. And then I'm also, spoiler, I'm also doing t-shirts. And the letters I made are for t-shirts that will be I'll be producing
awesome.
Next year.
Well, I definitely look forward to checking out that program when you finally release it. So I know a lot of people get into lugs once they come back into the Lego community, their Lego user groups. Are you a member of a local lug?
I am. I found Penlug, the same. I think I found Penlug a month before I started selling on Bricklink, or right around when I started. It was maybe it was might have been a year after. I don't know. Sometime 2009, 2010, I found Penlug. I found them by going to Brick Fair, Virginia, which at the time that was the only Brick Fair, was their Virginia one. They have 4 now. And I noticed that one of the groups of people who were displaying collaboratively were from Pennsylvania, which I had just come from. And I started talking to them, and they were very good ambassadors for the lug, and they invited me to the next meeting, which was maybe a half hour from where I live now, but it was maybe an hour and a half from where I was at college at the time. And it must have been 2010. September 2010 was my first meeting, I believe, because I had gone to Brick Fair in August of 2010. But I packed up the entirety of my store at the time, which was 100 or so used complete sets. I put them all in my car, all in bags, and I went to this meeting, and I, from day one, was the guy trying to sell the Lego fiends more Lego. And I didn't get thrown out or anything, so I guess I wasn't too obnoxious. But I, from day one with Penlug, I was the guy who was selling. And at that time, I definitely had somewhat of a private Lego collection as well, or at least I put myself out there as also being a builder or collector.
So how would you say you were received? You say you started selling almost from minute one in Penlug. How well do you say you were received at that time?
I don't know how many new members they were getting on a monthly basis at that point, but everyone seemed happy to come out to my car and look at all these sets in the trunk and in the back seat of the car. And this is my previous car at the time. And I definitely made some sales. I'm sure there are people who weren't interested in buying used complete sets in any amount. And I didn't have much Castle or Pirates at the time, I combined Castle and Pirates into each set being bagged individually into the same box, and I wrote like Castle Pirates or Pirate Castle on it. And I remember I was scoffed at for combining the two of them, as they have nothing to do with each other. They would never be in the same place at the same time. Okay, that's fine. But I did manage to sell a few things there, but since I had my store open for about a year at that time, I probably didn't have the greatest of inventory still in my possession.
Okay, so that would have been around 2010, right?
Yeah, that should have been like September 2010.
Okay. So from then, have you participated actively in Penlug?
I've been to almost every Penlug meeting since then. The only ones I haven't gone to are when I'm out of town and for Brickfest Live, which I missed a fair amount of the meetings in the last 2 years for being out of town. But I'll be going to all of them going forward. I have been selling bulk by the pound at Penlug meetings for 6 months now, something like that. I've been bringing, since May of 2016, I've been bringing a kiddie pool full of bulk and a scale and a bunch of gallon bags. And
oh, wow.
I try to get brand new used bulk every month. I clean it myself. I bring it to the meetings. People buy what they want to buy. They don't buy what they don't want to buy. And then I bring fresh the next month. I don't bring the same bulk that they've seen twice, which I think they're appreciative of. So I'm still continuing to make Penlug my private sale operation once a month. I only wish there were more meetings like that I could go to locally.
Okay. So I understand that Bricks on the Dollar was not the first name you gave your Bricklink store. Can you tell us what that was, the first name?
The first name was the Flying Legogos, which is kind of like the Flying Legandos, and that was a reference to a portion of the first Lego PC game, which is Lego Island in 1997. That was a reference to that. I'm not sure what kind of brought it back up in my head. It was more than likely something my brother and I would just say at each other back and forth over the years. That's why it stuck for that long. At the time, you still can't use the term Lego in a store name on Bricklink. You can have Lego in your username, but you can't have it in your store name. So although I definitely spelled it with like sixes and zeros and threes and all that, It did not fly, and I'm not sure how long it took, but they made me change my name. I changed it at that point to Ice Planet 2009, which
Why
I think
that's... Why Ice Planet 2009?
Well, it was 2009 when I did it, and I guess I liked Ice Planet 2002, the theme, more than I let on. I think I mentioned that name on the Bricks and Beer show.
Okay. Yeah, it's actually where I believe you did mention that reference there. So when did you decide on the current name, Bricks and the Dollar? What's in the name?
Well, Ice Planet 2009, I don't believe lasted too long. I want to say the switch to Bricks and the Dollar was probably around the time I started selling parts in addition to just used complete sets in my store. Although I don't know if I could track the exact date I switched it over. Not sure if the emails go back that far. And I don't have a hard copy reference to all my orders in the last 6+ years. But Bricks on the Dollar was a spin on pennies on the dollar, which in itself is a phrase that just means cheap, discount, bargain, whatever you want. So I chose Bricks on a Dollar because at the time I was going for low prices. That was my angle on Bricklink. I had low prices for my sets, and then when I started listing used parts, I was going for low prices on them too. Whenever I was buying, I was always looking for low prices, even more so than trying to find a single store that had everything I needed. I was obsessively looking for the low prices. So I came up with Bricks on a Dollar. Everything was bricks rather than Lego, and it still is. So that's the name I settled on. I don't know if it was too over capitalistic in just picking a name that says to some people, I'm here to make money. But I never disliked the name.
Okay. So what would you say is important when it comes to picking a name, specifically when you're marketing to new customers? How important would you weigh the name of your Bricklink store?
I had a conversation with a new seller earlier today just about this. I'm glad this is lining up. But they were telling me that they need to pick a name for their store, and they were leaning towards something in the line of Quality Bricks, something like that. And I said, it's not going to work. You're trying to sell the same stuff to the same people at the same prices. You need to be edgy in some way. There's enough clean this and fresh that, quality this, fast this, best that, and store names. You need to do something that'll make you stand out and something that will make a customer even think about your store a little bit when they're considering buying more Lego. I think an edgy name or an interesting name is definitely the way to go with that.
You have like yeah. Asian Clicks, for example.
Yeah, that could work.
And you can't take it because I already have it.
I don't know what name this store is going to settle with, but I hope I did my job in convincing them that they should go for something more obscure or something unique and not just best bricks around. Like, would you shop at a store? Would you be interested in looking to see what a store called Best Bricks Around even has in stock? Would that entice you to click in and go, okay, what is Best Bricks? That's a hard one. Maybe that is a good one. Would you be enticed to go into Best Bricks Around and see, all right, what is the store all about? What are they selling? Because I'm somehow interested. I don't know that I would be.
Okay. Well, definitely choosing a name is maybe not the most important thing about a store, but it definitely has to stand out, like you said, because you have to be able to market to someone. And if someone doesn't know who you are, they have to start with something, and usually that's a name, and then they follow that by some kind of branding that comes around that, be it some kind of logo or something else that ties in often with marketing. So moving into the daily operations a little bit, what software do you use to make your business easier to run?
I have most of my business contained within Bricklink itself. They make it easy to run your entire store using just their website. There are no third-party applications that you are required to use to make Bricklink work successfully for you. If you want to make it easier or more efficient or more trackable, I definitely could not recommend enough using the free software Brickstock, formerly called Brickstore. That it's, to me, I could never go back to just using Bricklink after having tried Brickstock. It's way easier for exactly what I do when I have new sets coming in and I need to part them out into my store. Brickstock makes it way easier. I use that, and I also use Google Sheets to take care of all my bookkeeping. I had it on Excel, but then when Bricks on a Dollar expanded to be a 2-3 computer business instead of just this one, I decided to put it on Google Sheets so that it could be accessed live from any of the three laptops, so we weren't syncing the same file over and over again.
We'll get into more detail about logistics in the operations, but you do bring up a great point here where you had it in Excel, and rather than trying to use a Microsoft solution, which is a licensed solution, you turned to using the cheapest solution available, and that was Google Sheets, which is very similar to Excel. Would you say that would be a smarter decision for someone just starting out to always be looking at their bottom line to make sure they're not spending more than they have to?
I think Google has done a pretty good job of making Microsoft Office almost obsolete. Now, Google Sheets has nowhere near the power that Microsoft Excel has. I've firsthand witnessed Google Sheets just not being able to keep up, crashing and failing at particular things. One that really comes to mind is the ability to remove duplicates in a spreadsheet. You have to get a plugin for Google Sheets to be able to remove duplicates, but then it has severe limitations in that it cannot handle a job of a certain size for removing duplicates. So nothing's that heavy duty for the way I keep track of my orders and my spreadsheets for the company. So Google Sheets is definitely a good option for me, but when you're getting started, you should definitely watch your bottom line, because we'll get into infrastructure later, but the infrastructure alone is fairly expensive for running a Bricklink store. And Brickstock does have a paid version, but I don't know anybody who's ever paid for it. I'm not familiar with anybody who has done the paid version. I've even been told that I guess before it changed hands from Brickstore to Brickstock, it was all but abandoned, in that if you went to try to buy the paid version, you couldn't even do it at that point. So the free version was the only one available.
That's unfortunate. I've used so-called freeware in the past. And some of it I came to rely on to get some of my work done. In those cases, I'm more than happy to pay the developer, having been a developer myself, for their time and effort they put into getting that excellent piece of software, that tool, that utility done. And so with that in mind, I'm always happy to pay back and hopefully pay it forward is what I prefer to do. But paying back is also something I think developers should get. So paying for the free software, I think, actually enhances the software from my point of view. And of course, you know, if you're using it every day, then I think it, you can more than afford to pay back the developer. But that aside, what requirements would you say are required for your bookkeeping, your management of everything you do in your store?
The biggest requirement I'd have to say is time for that, because there's two ways you could do it. You could keep track of your bookkeeping as it comes in. So as orders come in, you take care of all the cells in the spreadsheet for each order, or you could wait and then batch it once a week, once a month, once a year even. It depends on how much traction your store is getting, how many orders you're getting. But I do it one at a time. I do it daily with making sure it's all in there. And I'm sure that's probably taking more time than if I batched it once a week, once a month, something like that. I'm coming in right at like 1,750 orders for the year. And I couldn't imagine trying to put that all together in a spreadsheet all at once, especially with Bricklink purging all data beyond 6 months. So you can't even wait a whole year for that. Time's the big one. The other one is, I guess, for bookkeeping, I would say making sure you have a tax solution. I'm sure it's different in every country, but I have a CPA that I go to once a year. I'm going to go on March 10th at 10 a.m. That's my appointment. So I got to go there. He knows all the right questions to ask me about write-offs and all this, and he does a great job. Aside from paying him his annual fee, I've never made enough money with Bricks on a Dollar to really get slammed in tax time. So having an accountant you can go to, or being competent enough yourself to handle taxes and all that, which, I mean, I could probably do it. I'd handle all the bookkeeping, so I could probably do the taxes, but I'd prefer to go to him and have that be done. Time, and I guess just knowing how spreadsheets work.
Okay, so how about requirements for managing your inventory?
Brickstock takes care of all that, and unless we're dipping a little bit into the infrastructure in that you need a label maker. Aside from that, Brickstock really takes care of all the inventory, and everything is on Bricklink. I get asked a lot about people outside of the business who they see it as, I've got a lot of inventory. I've got nearly 700,000 parts. And the first thing a lot of people ask me is, how do you keep track of the inventory? I don't even really have an answer for them, because it's all on Bricklink. It's live. If somebody buys it, it's no longer there. And every lot is linked to a physical location in my store, which is manually inputted every time you upload something fresh to your store. You put in where you're going to be putting it physically. And it's all on Bricklink. So I really enjoy that I don't have to come up with any sort of barcode scanner system or anything like that. It's all taken care of by Bricklink. Whether they set out to make it that easy or not, it's inventory management is very easy with Bricklink.
So if there's anything you wish could be added to either Bricklink or Brickstock that would make your business easier, what would you say that could be?
One time-saving function that Brickstock could add would be it already syncs with your Bricklink account, and that's how it's able to upload and update your Bricklink for you. But if it could sync far enough that you could see what lots are going to consolidate in your Bricklink store as you were putting away a bunch of sets you just sorted, that would be nice, because at the time being, you upload from Brickstock into Bricklink. It'll then tell you on Bricklink which ones consolidate and you can put them away, and then which ones are fresh, brand new to your store, in which you have to assign them a new location. If you could see those numbers, the consolidation numbers, before leaving Brickstock, you could save yourself a step in putting parts away first and then putting the rest of the parts away. It would make it more streamlined. But that's something I'd really like, is a little bit more insight on Brickstock as to your current Bricklink inventory.
Now, I recall watching episode on Ask Clutch, Free Lego episode 006. At minute 34, you mentioned you wished Bricklink or other software would provide better analytics for your sales in the store. How valuable would a tool be to you if such a type of tool existed?
There are very complex ways of getting these numbers from Bricklink. I just started a new one today, as a matter of fact. I guess I'm doing a lot of work these days, but I realized that you can download orders received or placed to Brickstock, and I always knew you could do this. I think it might have, that functionality might have been terminated at some point in the past, but it's working now. And I downloaded the entirety of December of my orders received to Brickstock. It opens each order as its own tab, so I had to roll them all into one at a time, cutting and pasting all the items in there. And then that left me with a file with every part that has sold through my store, every item that's sold in my store in December. And with that information, I could sort them by what sold the most, what sold the least. It's not necessarily how often it sold, but the total number that sold. It's very relative to how many you have in your store, because if you don't stock it, you can't sell it. But I could take the top 10, 20 items by volume that have sold in my store in December, or if I had enough time, I could do the whole year in one file. And I could look and see what current sets have all, if not most, of those parts in them. I could tailor my purchases to just those. I don't know if that would be a good or bad decision. It's certainly time consuming to come up with those numbers on your own without any kind of software written for it. But that's something that could lead savvy sellers down a path to making better buying decisions and stocking items that they need and not stocking items that they don't need.
So let's, you started talking about metrics such as what sold best, your top 10 and what have you. What metrics would you say you would need for such a utility? Best selling pieces by the month, quarter, year, dead inventory, quarter projections, current sales, profit, and expenses. What would you say? What are your thoughts?
I was looking recently at changing my quantity buys for any items I had more than 1,000 of in my store. I was going to change the quantity buy to just over the average sold per sale of those parts. And in that, I saw that they have how many have sold in the last 6 months and how many sales that was. So how many unique sales contained those parts and then how many total sold. That is a number you can only get through division. It's not posted anywhere, but a list of what parts sold the most over a month, over 6 months. I'm not gonna ask them to go back more than 6 months. They don't wanna do that. So I don't know, a week, a month, 6 months, how many parts, or what parts sold the most? What parts sold the most frequently? So the most sales of the part, not necessarily how many sold. Those would be pretty interesting. Bricklink has a very, very, very small statistics page that they've made even harder to find now. I don't even know if the URL has changed or if I could find it again if I wanted to, but they list the parts or any items really. You can change it, parts, minifigs, sets, whatever. What items are on the most wanted lists, which that's a fantastic thing to see, but I think it only shows the top 25 or so items. And then they also have what parts have sold the most in the last 6 months, but they only have 25 items. And if you look at it, it's all black and white and gray items, but including the friction pins that I have 12,000 of. But I think a little bit more functionality in those metrics would be very useful to some, no more useful to others who aren't concerned with that. But it could show you what maybe you need to sell off by weight and reinvest in better parts. I don't want all stores just to turn into stocking those 25 top items and nothing else. But
right.
I would love to know what people are buying, and something maybe along the lines of what price point some things are selling at in their majority of sales. And even if Bricklink could tell you what parts you should raise and what parts you should lower, I don't know if that's asking too much or if that's something they would even be concerned about, but
if they would, I'd imagine that'd be, even if they launched it as a separate service, that's something I would be interested in as a new Bricklink seller myself. Now, earlier you mentioned the pain in having to download everything and copy paste everything to a single sheet so you can consolidate it into numbers that mean anything to you. How critical would you say it is to compile these metrics on your own?
I haven't before a few days ago, I haven't ever considered trying to pull any metrics from Bricklink in order to tailor any sort of purchases. In trying to help another seller launch their own store, I've gotten a little bit more concerned with what should you buy, what shouldn't you buy. I've long held the belief that you should consider how much of a set is new to your store versus how much of a set consolidates in your store when you're going out to buy more things. I don't know that I ever actually did it myself. I should, but I don't think I ever have. But when you look at the part out value of a set on Bricklink, it will tell you how many lots of that set are new to your store, how many lots of that set are consolidating in your store. You could use that ratio to determine what percentage of that set is new to your store, and then you can then choose to only buy sets to part out in your store that are above a certain percentage of new to your store. Or if you want to go the quantity route, you can choose sets that are only below a certain percentage of new to your store items.
Now, as I'm sure we both know quite well, the lifeline and ultimate solution for anything that a business needs and requires is sales, sales, and sales. That's the ultimate solution to almost any business problem. As long as you have sales, it's no longer so much of a problem as the next sale will be. Now, you just mentioned earlier how it's critical that you keep a look at your bottom line, and when you are starting out, make sure that you don't just spend randomly. You are being critical and analytical in your process. And as you just mentioned now about metrics, if you don't know your metrics, then you're kind of spending wildly without that knowledge. Would you agree?
Yeah, I think many Bricklink sellers are definitely born into the world of spending wildly, especially with all the hype around swooping out there that I've been hearing so much about. Sales are definitely very important. Like I said earlier, if Bricklink could tell you what items you should lower in price and by how much, that wouldn't only be good for you, that'd be good for them, because if you lowered it enough that it was going to sell, they're going to get a cut of that sale. If you don't lower it and it doesn't sell, nobody gets anything. You're out the money for buying it and stocking it, and it's just sitting there virtually in your shelves.
Right.
Yeah. If, as far as starting, that's probably the most crucial time to really watch what you're buying. And I'm sure through my videos, I've led people down a better path than when I started buying sets to part out. When I started selling, it was just the used sets, and I had them all from childhood. So the only investment I really made, aside from infrastructure, was the parts I needed to buy to complete the sets that were incomplete in some way. But if you're starting with new parts from nothing, it's very important you pick the right sets and the right quantities to begin with. I've often thought about an experiment of, would you buy 100 of one set or 10 each of 10 different sets, assuming every set there is the same price and the same part count, etc. But it's right. It's an interesting path to go down, and I hope that I have launched others Bricklink stores through several different strategies. And I mean, I would love to hear what worked and what didn't work from all my ramblings that I haven't actually done myself.
Well, I'm sure as I interview other Bricklink sellers, we might actually get into some of those details in what didn't work. Now, from the beginning, thinking back, how does running a Lego business or a reselling business affect your personal life?
Aside from getting weird looks at the Lego store, it's an interesting business to tell people that you're meeting for the first time or you haven't seen in a while. It's an interesting thing to tell them what you do. I don't know that I've ever gotten any negative responses to telling a friend or family member that I sell Lego and here's how I do it. And I'm not just, you know, a miniature version of Toys R Us. I have all these parts and they're all sorted and people can buy just what they want and people know what they're buying. Everything has a number and a name and a color and all that. And it's incredibly time consuming, like any entrepreneurial feat is. So you have to, you and everyone around you has to know that if you're going to go down this road, it's going to mean that you're not going to have the same free time that you once had. Especially if you're trying to go full time with it. And I look to sellers like Brick Willett. Nick is he jumped in head first as a full-time seller, and his store is not even that big yet, but I can't imagine he's not doing well if he's hasn't grown past the size he is and he's still shipping out orders and still buying as much as he's buying. So I can't speak for him, but I think he's probably learned some good lessons and started down a pretty good path.
Yeah, I recently found Bricklink. Isn't he the one who bought a trailer? All his inventory in a trailer?
He retrofitted or he rehabbed an old trailer. I don't know if it's on wheels or if it's like the kind of like the mobile home, not mobile home, but the houses that are no longer mobile, but they were once mobile, that kind of thing. You know what I mean? Trailer yeah. park trailers. But he redid all the electric and the windows and I'm guessing HVAC for it. And he operates out of this trailer that he has parked on his property. I guess I think he lives on a farm or something like that. But he has a big enough space where he can put this trailer as an outbuilding to where he lives, and he commutes down the hill to the trailer and he works in there all day and all night.
So considering how you started Bricks on the Dollar, and I'm sure anyone who's watched your beginning of your Ask Clutch series when it was called Free Lego and the like, they know you operate out of your apartment, and your apartment was pretty much your inventory, your warehouse. Not a whole lot of room for wining and dining and throwing parties and the like. So how would you say running a business, especially in the first 6 to 12 months, affected your personal life in terms of relationships, friends, and potential significant others?
So I've had a girlfriend through the entirety of the store. I've had a girlfriend longer than the store has been around. So that's not really an issue, but I did definitely max out with that the last apartment I was in before I moved the store into this warehouse here. It was everywhere. I've done tour videos of it, and I think the most eye-catching part of the video was always that I had far too many kitchen cabinets than I really needed for cookware and all that stuff. So I had like the left two cabinets were just pick-a-brick cups full of parts, and people really got a kick out of that. I don't know if it was a feeling sad for me kind of thing, or feeling excited that there's Lego in the kitchen cabinets, but I definitely maxed out my space in that place, and I probably had half of what I have here now. And the video I was watching earlier from 3+ years ago when I was living there, it did say I had just under 200,000 parts in my store at the time. And it was a studio apartment. It was a very small apartment, and I had a bedroom that was basically the entire apartment, because everything that wasn't Lego was in that bedroom. And that's where I lived. It was the bedroom, the bathroom, the little bit of kitchen, and then the Lego was that made up the whole apartment. Definitely got some strange looks when maintenance from the apartment complex had to come in for any reason.
So now I could speak from personal experience, having tried to run a couple of ventures myself previously, where I'm doing 18-hour days, 20-hour days, getting little sleep. I'm online up and late. I'm writing code, or I'm constructing some kind of Word document, or getting into some kind of legal argument with someone, or discussing logistics and what have you, or going to some meeting. There's almost no time for anything other than what the business requires to keep going forward. And for me personally, it was very difficult to really give my mind any time to think about, oh yeah, I should probably go on a date with my girlfriend, or oh yeah, I don't have a girlfriend anymore, maybe I should go find one, or something to that effect. So being an entrepreneur it's not like you're throwing parties every weekend. If anything, the party is, how do I get my next sale? I'm not sure. Maybe you were the exception to that experience.
Hopefully you got most, if not all, of that.
Oh, okay. I guess we dropped out there.
It's still live.
It's still live. Actually, looking at the time, we're over an hour. Did you want to complete this section or pick up later?
I'm here all night. I'm fine with going. Keep going if you want.
Okay. All right. Let's go ahead and continue this section. We don't have that many more questions, but I think we have some really good responses here. Now, you were mentioning about your personal life and how you had a girlfriend even prior to starting the business venture. Let's kind of dig into that a little bit, because from my personal experience, running a business, starting a new venture and the like is something that is extremely time consuming. In fact, in my personal experience, I had almost no time to think about, oh, I should go find a new girlfriend, or I should start thinking about dating my current girlfriend, or anything along those lines. And I'm wondering if you had anything like that in your experience, where you were so consumed because that's the only thing you have to do, because if you don't make that next sale, you make no food for next week. I'm not sure if you ever had that.
She's always very supportive in that she works almost as much as I do. That's what our generation does. We work all day and we work all night. So I'm sure she would prefer that I just have a normal job like a normal person, come home in the evening and watch TV and et cetera. But because she works all day and all night and I work all day and all night, there was never really any issue with me trying to run my own business rather than getting a job.
Okay. Well, unfortunately, my experience is a little bit different. So this is one thing I wanted to highlight. When you're running a business, whether it be a Bricklink store or whatever, especially when it takes your personal time, it definitely is something you have to balance. You have to try to manage that time. Time is one thing. You never get a refund. And my wife is always, well, my girlfriend, my now wife, who was girlfriend at the time, she's like, you have almost no more time for me. You're too busy going out to some business or you're talking to someone, some investor or whatever. And why don't you spend more time with me? And so that becomes an issue. And perhaps it's not such a big issue for a starting Bricklink seller, but when you're doing entrepreneur activities and you're head first and your only source of income is if you can convince a investor to give you money, then everything relies on how much time and effort you put into getting that next paycheck. We still going? Okay, sound check. You still there, Chris?
I think so. Now okay. I'm back.
Okay. I'm not sure. Were you able to hear everything?
If there was a question at the end of it, I didn't hear the question, but I heard the prelude to that.
I see. The question more or less was, okay, I was highlighting actually how I felt business, when you're running a business, it's not all fun and games. There's a certain contribution you have to commit to in order for it to work. And if you don't put that time in, then it will fail. So coming back into how you started the business, compare your personal life now to how it was 6 years ago. Would you say anything is dramatically different, improved?
My lifestyle has definitely improved because of having taken the job with Brickfest Live for the last 2.5 years. I was able to move in a nicer apartment. I was able to buy a new car. And I was able to have the Lego not be in the apartment. Now, I don't know that all of those changes were warranted by just having the job that I had, because, I mean, now my rent's higher and now I have a car payment to make every month and all that. But I really appreciate now the separation between the at-home life and the at-work life. And it's been pitched to me that I should, instead of renting, because I'm moving out of this warehouse in the next few months, but instead of finding a new commercial space to rent, instead of my apartment, I rent a house, or I buy a house, and a portion of that is for the business and a portion of that is for living in, and overall it's cheaper than having two places. I don't know that I would do that for a few reasons. One of them is I like the separation of leaving home to go to work, even if it's the work that I define as work. It's my creation. And I mean, the other part of it is the security of having like clients and customers and employees and all that. And so where you live, I'm really not afraid of things like that, but I could see how a business that could expand at some point to levels that I can't even picture at the moment, I wouldn't want that to be based out of a home.
Right.
Yeah, I guess that's my answer.
So what difficulties would you say you encountered? What were the worst of the difficulties in running your Bricklink store out of your apartment?
Worst of difficulties. Hmm. Not having the ability to customize the space as much as I wanted, I kind of had to stay within the boundaries of here are where the walls are. Don't screw up the walls. People who live upstairs and next door, and you can't be making a lot of noise, pulling orders, or playing music, or sorting parts in the middle of the night, because when you're an entrepreneur, sometimes you work through the night instead of the day, because you can. And just keeping in mind other people who live there and people who will live there in the future after you leave, and what state you leave the apartment in, you can't really customize it as much as you'd want to a commercial space. So there wasn't really any hardships aside from not being able to lay it out the way I wanted to. At the time, I wasn't really looking to entertain company too much at the apartment. So the fact that you had to walk through this death trap of Lego in order to get to the small room that was my living space wasn't a big deal.
Okay, so when you first started, did you ever have any doubts about starting Bricks on the Dollar? Was it something you felt like you could survive on?
I never planned to survive on it. I plan to survive on it someday. I haven't reached that point yet still after 6+ years, but I've always had a job in some capacity, even if it's very part-time, while I've been running this business. I had jobs in college when I launched the business. I worked at the radio station after college, and then I worked at Brickfest Live after that. In 2 days' time, it'll be the first time while running Bricks on a Dollar that I have not had any other employment. So it's full entrepreneur, diving in head first, make it or break it kind of situation going forward. I would absolutely love to have the support, me or a family, or just to know that. That's why I like mentoring people who are going to wind up running stores that are much larger than mine. It might be seen as foolish to train who's going to be replacing you or outdoing you in the same marketplace. But I really like to see stores follow my guidelines and get to a point where they come back to me and they say, you know, it's working. Thank you. Here's how well it's working. And maybe, just maybe, I can see that same kind of situation for myself when I get to that size. I like seeing the foreshadowing of success through other stores.
Well, like you mentioned earlier, thought experiments would be great. Something you may not be able to carry out on your own, but if someone else did one of your thought experiments and proved it successful, that's one way you could just say, oh, okay, so it worked. Let me do it now.
Yeah.
So when you first started Bricks on the Dollar, how did you make ends meet? Did you run your store part-time or also working at a full-time job? I think you mentioned you were doing radio in college. Is that right?
I had a few jobs when I was in college, a few part-time jobs that I was doing. At that point, I was just barely getting into the parts. I was selling sets and I was selling used parts at the time. It wasn't until right after college that I started. I had a temp job for 2 months after college, and I started buying and sorting and uploading parts from new sets after that. I remember not doing much of the work at this temp job, which is completely unrelated to me leaving the temp job, but not doing too much work there and spending a lot of time online learning how to research what sets to buy. Now, I don't think I was following any sound practices as far as figuring out what I should be buying, but I remember remember looking at the Toys R Us site and seeing things are on sale, and little did I know that they marked them up to begin with, or that I wouldn't expect to see those online prices when I actually go into the store, or even the titles that they had online, I wouldn't expect to see them in the store. But I would go on my way home from this job, I would go to the Toys R Us, and I would be like, all right, there it is. There's the City of Atlantis set. I saw that on the website. It's got a good part-out value. It's got those new fluted columns in white. I should buy the City of Atlantis set. How many should I buy? I don't know. One, maybe two. And I didn't start parting out new sets until after college, but I had a temp job, and then immediately after that, I left the temp job to start the job at the radio station, which turned, I mean, that was the career path I had chosen. So I always had a career in mind while doing the entrepreneurial efforts. And it didn't take too long at the radio station to realize that it's not for me, and perhaps a career isn't either. So it was much more part-time than I would have liked. I worked very few hours at the radio station, and I guess my buying decisions probably weren't the worst. They definitely weren't the best with the Lego I was buying, but I guess I was selling enough to make it worthwhile. I didn't have like rent to pay for the store itself, and I didn't have an employee at the time, so that most likely made it a lot easier to afford all my expenses. I was at a cheaper apartment that I was splitting with somebody else, and I worked very few hours for my job, so the rest of it was just selling this and selling that.
Well, you mentioned you were buying all kinds of sets, and you're looking at advertisement as guidance for what you should buy. And there's a little bit of marketing involved there, which we could dig into in another session. But more importantly, you're buying things. So my question becomes, how did you manage your cash flow issues, especially from the beginning? You were running multiple part-time jobs as well as the store. How did you manage your cash flow?
I definitely think I saw the appeal of growing the store, and any sales that came in were really reassuring to me, even if they were nowhere near the expenses I had put out to buy the sets. Anything that was selling was a proof that I could sell things. Parts would sell. So I probably put in way more than I should have to start with, not anywhere near like a startup investment, but I was using my own money that I had, which, you know, that's all gone. I don't actually have any money that I call my own anymore, but I must have at that point in time had money in bank accounts or something that I was putting into Lego, and I guess my expenses were just a lot lower back then in life, because I was able to buy sets all willy-nilly. I bought this clearance and I bought that clearance, and I don't know the last time I actually bought clearance now, because we'll talk about that at some other point, but buying clearance sets is really not the answer for growing your Bricklink store.
Yeah, we could definitely dig into that in another session, as I do have questions related to that. So, you know, cash flow issues, always at the beginning of any new business, is definitely something everyone has to keep a critical eye on. And if they can't make sales, they have to look at their metrics to see why and if they can fix that with more sales. So, and with any adventure you start, you were fortunate enough to have a girlfriend and your family, hopefully not too far away. How would you say your support structure was set up with family and friends at the beginning of your venture?
When I started it, I was in college, so family wasn't that far away. It wasn't until when I started the radio job in August of 2011, that was the same month in which my family, because I moved out in my first apartment, which I shared with somebody. That was the same month that my family then moved to New York State. So I'm currently the only one in my family who lives in Pennsylvania, and I have been since 2011. So everyone basically moved away. Not that that really affects the business at all, but everyone kind of moved away, and I was forced, if I wanted to stay in the area with my job and all that, I was forced to make it happen. And I think having a YouTube channel was a lot more important then than it might be now as far as getting exposure. As I mentioned earlier, there just weren't as many stores back then that could also factor into being able to make the sales. I don't think I started really tracking any sort of bookkeeping until I was first 1099'd by PayPal, which I guess that was early 2013 for the 2012 annual year.
Wow, 4 years into your business.
Yeah. Well, it's 20,000 or 200 transactions through PayPal, and I don't think I hit that until sometime in 2012. So I didn't really. I don't know that I ever really saw it as a business as much as I saw it as a hobby, running a business as a hobby or as something to do, something fun, something exciting. I don't think I saw it as a business until early 2013 when I had to all of a sudden figure out what I spent, what I made, and how I'm going to get out of paying a lot of money for taxes. And I went to H&R Block, and they had no idea what they were talking about. So they told me how much I would have to pay, and I knew that was just wrong. So I talked to the people I worked with at the radio station, and they recommended the accountant that I use now, that they all went to this accountant. I started going to him. He made things a lot easier. I didn't mind at all paying him his annual fee to just keep me going in business and all that. And it's now a business. At that point, it became a business as I got an employee. And I think the first 2 years of having part-time employees, I didn't 1099 them. I just ate the expense of their pay. It wasn't until I was encouraged by the CPA I can't stomach the $17,000 I gave John last year as just a profit I should have in the store, especially as a sole proprietorship business. So I learned how to 1099 the employee, and they get everything tax-free to begin with, and they just have to be responsible enough to have 23% of it or so at the end of the year so they can pay that away. That's always right. Fun, I'm sure. And so, yeah, I'm geared up to issue a couple 1099s for 2016 next month.
So getting back to the beginning of your operation, what would you say your worst pain? We talked about difficulties. How about your pain in managing Bricks on the Dollar in the first 2 years?
The biggest thing I can think of is that when I started with stack-ons and organizing my inventory, I did not number the drawers sequentially, numerically, and assign drawer numbers to parts. Back then, it was more obvious to me that every part has a number, a part number. Some of them are 2 digits, some of them are 3 digits, some of them are 4, 5, 8 digits. Some of them have X's, some of them have BBs at the beginning of them. But everything has a number. So I thought, why don't I just number all the drawers with all the part numbers of the items that I actually have in stock, and the orders received are spit out by default in order of part number. So I could just go down and they're still in the same order they need to be as I'm working my way through and pulling all the parts for each order. The only The real difficulty came when I added new parts or I sold out of a part and I wasn't planning on getting any more of that. And then now there's these drawers that are numbered for no good reason. And I did more than I care to admit of drawer shifting, like two in each hand at a time, shifting all the drawers down to make an opening for something fresh that I'm right about to put in. I don't know when I turned the corner and started numbering them sequentially and putting those numbers in the remarks field on Bricklink, but it couldn't be something much more stupid than sorting them by part number and labeling all the drawers with those part numbers.
Yeah, you've definitely hit a topic that we'll dig into further in the next session on daily logistics. So, we'll dive deeper into that in the next session. We're coming pretty close here to the end here, but I do want to ask you, thinking back to the beginning, did you ever think you would have ever built a brand and business around reselling Lego?
I don't think I could ever have imagined where this would have gone. Back then, I would have thought, why would I try to make a new brand? Lego already has a brand. They already offer pieces. They have stores all over the world. They have amusement parks. They've got movies. They've got all these things. Why would I try to compete in that realm? I don't know that I ever had a plan for how I was going to get from A to B with my brand, but I'm really happy with where B has fallen.
Okay. So the critical point of this question is to be advisory, to provide some kind of view forward for any potential Bricklink seller to understand that when they first start, if they're starting with the intention of making it a business, then that's different than starting as, oh, this is fun, it's hobby, oh, and it happens to make a little bit of money here and there. So it's a different mindset. And it's interesting to hear how different people approach where they were to how they became.
I definitely started it as not a business, as a hobby. That probably goes definitely in line with, as you said, someone without any business training going into this and somehow not failing kind of thing. I can't explain that, but it was a hobby to me. It still is a hobby to me in some respects because I enjoy it. I like seeing where it goes. I think running a business is the hobby to me. It doesn't necessarily have to be based around Lego. But the hobby of running a business is my job.
Well, you mentioned earlier that you eventually picked up some employees, be they part-time or more than part-time. For considering a new Bricklink seller, at what point would you advise a new store reseller that they should start getting or looking at getting another employee to help them run the store?
It depends on if the person running the store is going to be doing it full time or not. As I've been doing this less than full time for the last 2.5 years, it was important that I bring on an employee about 2 years ago when I was not going to be able to keep up with the day-to-day activities on my own in the evenings after having worked a full day at work. They say that entrepreneurs really don't burn out that easily, but after putting in 8 hours, I wasn't at 100% still to come up here and do another 8 hours or more. So it was necessary for me to get an employee to train how to do things and to take off all of the easier and the automatable tasks like pulling orders, shipping orders, uploading parts, sorting even. Every employee I've had, I started them with sorting, and it's sorting's not for everybody. And at this point, I do most of the sorting. I don't pay for sorting anymore. I have people who come in and sort very part-time who work for store credit. And if you're a store owner and you're looking to start a store, you've recently started your store, and you should consider finding a local lug or joining a lug. Just get to know the people who are buying the product from you. Not necessarily those people specifically, but the types of people who are buying the product. And then see if any of them want to experience the business. You can put it that way if you want. You want to come experience the business for store credit? You never know who's going to enjoy sorting an hour here, an hour there, or a lot if maybe they're retired, or maybe they're just got nothing better to do. Maybe they want to work sorting for you a lot and get a lot of store credit, because everybody buys something different and you don't know what they're going to want, and you need to get the parts sorted. That's the bottom line.
Well, and definitely. And I wouldn't say entrepreneurs never burn out. We certainly do. The only thing that keeps you going and not just completely quitting, or maybe you do quit, is that desire, that burning need to eat tomorrow or next week. And in order to do that, if you're not bartering for your skills, you're doing something to bring in another paycheck. And so to that end, you have to manage your time. And I might interject that the time you bring other people on is when you decide you ultimately yourself don't have the time to do everything necessary in, say, a 24-hour period. If you get like 100 orders, if you can't pull that yourself, then maybe you should consider bringing someone in part-time to do that, things like that, perhaps. You think you could add to that?
Definitely. It's not only that I couldn't get it all done in a 24-hour period. It was that once there's enough work where the quality of the work starts to diminish, in that I can't get orders pulled fast enough where every customer is still happy. When we get a backlog for one reason or another, a long holiday weekend, or maybe I had John work for the Brick Builders Club for one day, and that's a whole day lost for bricks on a dollar at the time being. When I get that first email from somebody saying, "Hey, I paid for this like 2 days ago. When did you plan on shipping it?" I know that we've got a certain backlog going that is not necessarily acceptable. And I think it was reaching that point where I decided to get an employee. Although when John started, he was just sorting, and John was not my first employee. I've had many sorters, but John was the first one that I had trained to pull and ship orders. So it was getting to the point where the quality of my brand was diminishing because I couldn't do it all in the given amount of time. So I brought on John more to protect the brand than to expand the sales or the potential of the business.
That's an excellent point to bring in. It's not just about sales, but also maintaining the expected quality and assurance that you're delivering everything expected from bricks on the dollar. And I think this is a good point to discuss, and we can definitely continue to discuss more on this. But looking at the time, we've actually been going at this for 2 hours now, and I originally intended for this to be only 1 hour episodes. At this point, I think it would be good if we could sort of take a break here, and I will schedule another day where we can have another conversation on a time that's mutual to both of us in not too distant future, maybe a couple days or next week or whatever we decide on at a later given time. But I definitely thank you for your time and effort to listen to my questions and hopefully provide excellent feedback to anyone looking at our show. I think we had a few people come on. But ultimately, the goal of this conversation is to create an ebook that I will compile from all the conversations I have with Bricklink sellers who have been online for at least 5 years, and more or less get an understanding of how they came to build that business, with the hopes of giving the best advice and best practices from each of those experiences to new entrepreneurs looking to sell Lego online. So once again, Chris, I want to thank you again, or should I say Clutch, thanks again. And anyone else who is interested, by all means, drop by his store, check it out, Bricks on the Dollar. I'll update the description later, so it will give you a link directly to his store. But you can also go to his website, bricksonthedollar.com. And once again, I thank everyone for participating, and I hope to see you again in the next session. Thanks again, Chris.
You're very welcome.
And so I hope to see you again. And with that, I'll see you next time.